Hi, my name is Qing. So my talk today is security improvement in GCC. So I'll start from the a security wish list that was requested for the Linux kernel for a long time, and then we choose two of the important security feature to implement it and add it into the latest GCC. These two features, the first one is core used registers wiping on return, which is added to GCC 11. And the second one is stack variable auto initialization, which is added to GCC 12 recently. And then after that, some future work. There are quite some security feature that was requested for the Linux kernel for a long time. So this is a list which compare the GCC and the clone on a set of the security feature. So there are basically, the wish list include speculative load headering, core use register wiping on return, and stack variable auto initialization, and structure layout randomization, and etc. Yeah. So some of the features has been in other compiler, for example, the clone or Microsoft compiler for some time. For example, the stack variable auto initialization has been available in other compiler already. But GCC missing those features, and this makes it GCC less competitive with other compiler in the security area. So for over one and a half year, we have been working very hard in this area to try to make GCC comparable or work even better than other compiler. So I'll talk a little bit on the first feature we added into GCC. It's called core use register wiping on return. I'll start from the motivation first, and then several important questions and the answer. After that, the new feature added to GCC 11, a status of the patch. Then I'll conclude the first feature with a summary of the implementation detail and acknowledgement. So why this feature? Yeah, why we need the core use register wiping on return? Mostly there are two major purposes. The first one is to mitigating return-oriented programming attack technique. The second one is try to prevent information leakage through register. Yeah, so there are This is a two major purpose for this task. So why the core use register wiping can mitigate ROP? We need to understand the features of ROP first. So for ROP, that's a return oriented programming. It's one of the most popular code reuse attack techniques. And ROP usually execute gadget chains to perform malicious tasks. So a gadget chain usually is a carefully chosen machine instruction sequence that already in the existing memory, machine memory. So each target, each gadget usually ends in a return instruction, and located in a subroutine within the existing program or shared library code. One important feature of the RP is the destination of using gadget chains, usually called system function, to perform malicious behavior. So the registers usually are used to pass parameters for these system functions. So we can see the return instruction. Before the return instruction, the register might be used for passing the parameter to the system function. So this is a major feature of the gadget of the RP. After understand the feature, we know if we clean the scratch registers that are used to pass parameter at return instruction, then we can break the gadget chain and effectively mitigate the RP attack. So for more detail, you can refer to this paper at least in the bottom of this slide. The second motivation is to prevent information leakage through registers. One of the well-known security techniques is stack and the register erasure, which ensures that on return from a function, no data is left on the stack or in registers. Actually, there is a separate patch. I remember this as an old patch, address the stack erasure problem, which has been submitted, but I'm not sure what's the status right now. But for this core use register wiping task, we can address the register erasure problem at the same time. Yeah. After understand why we need this feature, we then need to answer two important questions to decide the design. The first question is, which registers should be cleaned at the return of the function? The short answer is the caller saved, that is the call used or call clambered registers. Actually, for RP mitigation purpose, only the call used registers that pass parameters need to be cleaned. That should be enough for the RP mitigation. But for the register erasure purpose, all the core used registers need to be cleaned. Because there are different security need for different user, and also there are also the runtime overhead issue we need to consider. So we should provide multiple levels of control to the user. And then the second question is why we choose to zero the registers other than randomize them. The short answer is first, zero tends to be the safest choice as it's less useful to be used as a meaningful size or an index or a pointer. And usually generated machine code for zero is faster and smaller than the machine code for other non-zero constants. So we choose to use zero to clean the registers. After answer those important questions, we now know what kind of interface functionality we need to add into GCC. We add a command line option along with a new matching function attribute. So it's called F0 core use registers with a sub option to choose the subset of the core used register to be cleaned. So this option for choose the subset, yeah, it's basically there are three basic choice. It's skip, used, and all. Skip means none of the core used register need to be cleaned. Used means those register that are used in the function need to be cleaned. And all means all the core use register should be cleaned. So in addition to these three basic choices, we have two more modifier can be added to further restrict the core use register set. The GPR to restrict into the only the general purpose registers, and the AIT is added to restricted the register that can pass parameters. So with the three basic choice and these two modifier, we have a combination of total nine combination to choose which subset of the core use register should be cleaned. So we can provide a multiple level to the user to choose. So this patch has been committed to GCC 11 on October last year, and it's the original commit has a full support for x86 and Arch64. And on x86, an optimized implementation was provided. Later on December last year, Spark was supported by defining the new target hook, target zero core use registers. This year on July, the Linux kernel was configured to use this feature to improve the kernel security. So let's take a look of a little more detail of this patch. So for this patch, we add a new path and also a new target hook. So the new path is added in the beginning of the late compilation. It's called path zero core use registers. In this new path, we scan the exit block from backwards to look for return. And for each return, we compute the head register set, need zeroed head register based on the user request from the option, the data flow information to compute whether it's used or not, and the function ABI information to see whether it's a core used or it's a parameter passing register or not. And then we pass this computed head register set to the new target hook and to generate the instruction sequence, zero the register set. So that's the new path. And for the new target hook, the default implementation is in the middle end, and it will generate a sequence without any target specific optimization. But on the x86 backend, we provided a optimized implementation for the target hook. This is quite big project, and this took over half a year to finally commit it. During the discussing and patch revision process, a lot of people provide help and idea, help me go through all the every problem. So I really appreciate all the help from people from the community. Thanks a lot. Yeah. So this is for the first feature. And the second new feature we added into GCC is stack variable auto initialization. We also start from the motivation and then the new feature added. And after that, a status of the patch and then concluded with a summary of the implementation and acknowledgement. Yeah. So for the stack variable, yes, they are quite some of the language, popular language, for example, C++, the stack variable is not initialized by default. So for uninitialized variable, usually it hold a junk data before which is in the memory before the function was invoked. So the junk data in the uninitialized variable might result in incorrect computation or change the program behavior unpredictably. And sometimes the attacker can pre-initialize the uninitialized variable in order to enable some malicious code execution. And also, if a stack variable, an initialized stack variable is a locked variable, it might cause a race condition. Yeah. So it's quite dangerous with uninitialized stack variable. It might have some other bad impact as well. Yeah. So we need to fix all this uninitialized variable. Because it's a very tedious work to identify all the uninitialized variable in the a very big software product. So tools are needed to detect the uninitialized variable. Currently, we have static tools and the dynamic tools. For the static tools, for example, for GCC and Clang, they both support the uninitialized variable warning. And for Visual Studio, it provides an analysis plugin for this purpose. For the dynamic tools, both GCC and Clang provide the address memory sanitizer, which catch the uninitialized variable during the runtime. There are also a standalone tool, Valgrind, which also for this purpose. Yeah, so there are quite some tools available right now, but there are some limitations for all these tools. For the static tools, because there are some limitation of the analysis. For example, first, because most of the static tools based on intra-procedure analysis, so it has to assume the code function initialize every parameter. Yeah. And also inside the function, there also has some limitations for uninitialized array or initialized pointers due to some various index might only be known during the runtime. And also there are some potential infeasible paths due to the conditional expression cannot be evaluated statically during compilation time. So as a result, the static analysis tool usually has the major issue is false positive. Of course, there are still false negative at the same time. For the dynamic tools, the major issue is false negative because the dynamic tools usually catch the issue during runtime, but runtime it cannot execute all the possible execution paths. So the major issue is false negative. Of course, there are some occasionally false positive issue. Another big issue with dynamic tools is the runtime overhead is quite big. And also the size of the log are very large and had to be analyzed. So yeah, due to this limitation of the available tools, it's impossible to detect all the uninitialized variable before the final production. So there are still some missing case that for the uninitialized variable in the production, software production. So there is a need for the compiler to automatically initialize all the uninitialized variable during compilation time for the production build for security purpose. Right now, both software Microsoft compiler and Clang already support this feature. They provide a compiler time the first class option to provide a zero or pattern initialization. For the pattern initialization, it's used in the development build for debugging purpose. For the zero initialization, it's usually used in production build for security purpose. Yeah, so but both the Microsoft and Clang supported, I think, last year. Yeah, but the GCC missing this this feature. So for this year, we have start working on this feature and have a long discussing start at the beginning of this year till now over several months. And finally, we agree on the final patch and add to the GCC 12. So the new features added to the GCC 12 is the user interface is quite simple. It's just a new GCC option along with a matching attribute for variable. So this GCC option is trivial auto variable initial. So the name is exactly the same as Clang in order to comparable with Clang. There are three choices for the initialization. The uninitialized pattern and zero, and default is uninitialized. Means doesn't initialize anything variable. Pattern will initialize with values that will likely transform logic bugs into crashes. So this is mainly for the debugging purposes. A zero will initialize the static variable with zeros. It usually should be used in the production build. The attribute for variable is mainly for performance purpose. The marked variable is uninitialized intentionally. So for example, if there's a big array, a stack array, it will be initialized manually in the function, and you don't want the compiler to automatically initialize it. You can use this attribute to mark it to improve to avoid the performance penalty. And the third feature we need to keep in mind is this new feature, new option will still keep the current static warning on an initialized variable untouched. So that's our goal. So in order to avoid forking the language issue, there are a lot of discussing in the very beginning of this task to complain this feature might fork in the language. So we need to Okay, thank you. this patch is committed to GCC 12 two weeks ago. Yeah, so I'm happy with that. But after the initial commit, there are some bugs filed and fixed. And also there are some bugs filed but not fixed yet. Thanks a lot for Richard Burney to help me fix the first three bugs, and there are still four bugs, open bugs remaining for fix. I will work on them after this LPPC conference. Yeah. Yeah, a summary of this patch. So we have three major requirements for the patch. We need to initialize all variables, including the structure padding. And we need to keep the static warning unattached. And we need to minimize runtime overhead. So in order to meet all this requirement, the implementation becomes not a trivial task. So after long discussing, we finally decide to introduce a new internal function to represent the initialization. Yeah, so yeah, I will skip the detail of this initial function. And in the gamification phase, we add the call to initial function for every auto variable that does not have a explicit initializer. And during the RTL expansion phase, we expand this call to this internal function. To the real initialization. And in order to maintain the uninitialized warning, we need to adjust the uninitialized variable analysis phase with the new depths to this internal call. Also, in order to minimize stack usage, we need to adjust the scalar replacement phase with the new calls to this internal function. So there are also some other change details. I'm not get more details there. So yeah, also for this task, it's very, involve a lot of discussing, involve a lot of different compiler phases. So people from the community provide a lot of insight and idea help during this process. So many thanks to all the people help me. So some future work. For core use register wiping, currently there are two open bugs need to be fixed first. And then after that, I believe when more people use this feature, there will be some potential correctness and the performance issue will be reported, and I will address them when needed later. Yeah. And for stack variable auto initialization, there is one known issue need to be addressed first. So we all know this issue before the commit. That's a missing warning. Uninitialized warning for address taken variable. I think the fix should be in the uninitialized analysis phase. I have a plan to fix it as soon as possible. And there are some open bugs need to be fixed. Yeah, mentioned in the previous slide. And I believe more potential correctness and the performance bugs might be reported later when more people use this feature. So that's it for my talk. Any questions? I'll happy to take.
Hi, it's Jose. I have collected some questions that have been made in the chat in the shared notes.
Oh,
but
okay.
It's easier for you to find them.
So many
So no, but if you look at the shared notes.
Oh, shared notes. Okay,
yes.
Okay. Thank
you. I have extracted the questions for you there.
Thank you. Thank you, Jose. How does CoreGestion working perform compared to control flow integration? Question: Clown performs local initializer in founder. How is it? Yeah, there's a question from Alexander. Clown performs local initialization in the front end. How is this done in GCC? Also, do you have any performance data for GCC implementation? Clown performs this initialization in the front end, and it didn't introduce any internal function, as we did, because they provide I initialize the Wangling analysis is also done in front end, and they have a good data flow analysis in front end. So that's very surprising me. So for GCC, because I initialize the Wangling analysis is in middle end, and it's also quite late. So we have to introduce a new internal function for this purpose. So that's the complicated part of the GCC implementation. Yeah, so because Clown has a data flow analysis in the front end. Yeah, so but we don't. I do have performance data in the very beginning of the design, and I provide that performance data to the GCC patch alias, and I can get that data if you are interested, and send to the GCC alias. And the performance data is good. I think I think the performance data, we think it's good, at that time. Another question, does register erasure work across long jump or C++ rowing? Does the register erasure work across long jump or C++ rowing exception? I think this register erasure, that one, we only erase the register at the return instruction. So not sure whether it's work across the long jump or not. I think we during the choose which procedure need to be do the register erasure, we already exclude those function with the long jump. That's my memory, but I'm not quite sure on this. I need to check. How does Alexander has another question, is how does core register wiping perform compared to control flow integrated instrumentation provided by Clown? Register wiping perform. You mean the register control flow integrated? I didn't compare these two techniques before, so I don't have a good answer to this question. Not sure anyone else has a good answer for this.
And I think we need to take that offline. We're sort of getting over time. As a quick question, if Florian has, but no more questions in the shared notes, please.
I think we can update long jump, the implementation of long jump, to clear the registers unconditionally at the 3 or 4 additional instructions there, and then you always come out of the long jump with those registers cleared. Maybe that's an option.
You mean include the long jump, right? Currently, we might exclude it, but we might need to include it for the completeness, right?
Yeah, it's an assembler implementation on most targets, I think, and we can add the additional register clearing to the assembler implementation of long jump.
Yeah, I think that might, but that should be done in the middle end, right? For the long, currently we find the place we need to clean. We need to clean the register during the middle end. So at that point, we choose which function, which return we need to insert the register zeroing. So that should be done. If we want to include the long jump, we might need to done it in the middle end. That's the target, the target hook part.
I was thinking about the long jump function, not the GCC built-in of the same name.
Yeah, long jump function.
It's in glibc, so you wouldn't change GCC for that.
Oh, okay. You mean just for the long jump function itself?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Then you don't have to clear things before you go into long jump.
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Sorian, for that suggestion. I think we're over time now and should give people a couple of minutes for the plan break now.
Okay.
So let's take everything else. Thanks very much, Jing, for your very interesting presentation. Glad that you're working on this improving security so that the GCC and Clang and the Microsoft compilers are all equivalent on this. So we'll take a break for about 7 minutes left and start again at 15 minutes past the hour for the next set of presentations for the second half of this track. So thanks very much. Great talk, great presentation by everybody. And again, thanks to all the great sponsors of the Linux Plumbers Conference this year.